Now on BBC One Northern Ireland, the very best of sporting action in the Championship.
Good evening. It's 31 years since Ulster had a team in two successive All-Ireland finals. Today, Donegal were hoping to follow Down's example last year, reach the final and so bridge that long gap. But their opponents were Mayo, the champions of Connacht, and the men from Donegal have yet to produce the goods on the big day at Croke Park. Donegal's first failure was in 1972. Brian McInniff played on the team. In 1974, they lost to Galway, and in 1983, McInniff as manager, they fell again to Galway, despite scoring this goal. McInniff returned as manager in 1989, and a year later, he had assembled a strong squad, but Meath proved too good. Four All-Ireland semi-finals, four defeats. 12 of today's Donegal team survived from that defeat by Meath 2 years ago. That should help. From the Ulster final, Barry McGowan comes in at right corner back and Tony Boyle has recovered to play at full forward. Boyle had been a doubt ever since this moment, a rash tackle by Anthony Tohill of Derry, and the Donegal man had to depart the Ulster final proceedings a short time later. At training this week, Boyle was finally past fit. The rumours about his fitness existed right up to about 3:15 this afternoon. Mayo's full forward is Liam McHale, the basketball player, 6'6", and that gave him a height advantage of 8 inches on Matt Gallagher. TJ Kilgallen is another key man at midfield, as is Peter Ford in defence. So those are teams, the scene set for Donegal against Mayo. In the commentary box, Peter McGinnity and Jimmy Smith.
Tommy Sugru from Kerry gets this All-Ireland semi-final underway then between Mayo, the champions of Connacht, and Donegal, this year's Ulster champions. The first man on the ball is Martin McHugh. A first shot then, first attack for Donegal. Martin McHugh, centre-half forward, kicked the ball wide for a second. The ball tailed in the air and then went to the right of the post and wide. Donegal in their traditional colours, but a change strip today, as are Mayo. Mayo come here, 34 times they've won the Connacht title. Donegal can only claim to have won the Ulster Championship on 5 occasions. Donegal again, James McHugh, Martin's brother, fouled. There'll be a free then for Donegal. And Donegal playing with the wind, Peter, it's important that all these chances are taken.
Indeed it is. The breeze, not very significant, but still will aid the leg of this free from Declan Bonner. Conditions but will suit Donegal. I feel they will. The ball is dry, it'll suit their forward line. And even at this early stage, Martin McHugh and James McHugh have both got themselves into the game. Very important for Donegal, that.
The kick, centre of the field, Tony Boyle, a judge to have fouled. Peter Ford, the fullback, Tony, very heavily strapped. There were rumours before the game that he wouldn't actually play, but I'm sure Donegal fans are very glad to see that he's taken his place out on the field, albeit with his knee very heavily bandaged. Gabriel Irwin then, who replaced Eugene Lavin in the Mayo goal, takes the kick out. Sean Maher gets Mayo on the attack. And now it's Kevin Staunton. Staunton up towards Liam McHale. That'll be a ploy I'm sure we'll see many times today. Liam McHale, 6'5", and no doubt the perfect target man if and when the need arises.
Well, I presume, Jimmy, that's why Liam McHale has been cited at full forward here, so that Mayo can, in desperation if necessary, pump the ball in high. Here we go again.
Staunton punts it in. towards McHale, but Mark Gallagher got his hand in the ball. The ball jumped to Finnerty, and the first score in the semi-final falls to the man from Moycullen, Anthony Finnerty. No stranger to that end of the field. He scored an all-important goal for Mayo in the All-Ireland final of 89. But more importantly for Mayo today, he has opened the scoring, and Mayo lead by that single point. Gary Walsh then with the kick out. An important sector is the middle of the field. That's well collected there by Ray Dempsey. Dempsey in turn feeds Jarlath Jennings. Jennings favours the left foot. It was fouled by Martin Shovlin. And with this free on the right hand side of the field, I'm sure it will be Jarlath Jennings himself who will take the free, which is on the 20 metre line. Martin Shovlin wasn't too pleased that he conceded that free, as it gives Jarlath Jennings an early opportunity to find the range and take his point and put Mayo into a 2-point lead. Donegal captain flicked it on. James McHugh picks the ball up. He has help inside or outside of him. He certainly needs it. There's five Mayo men there. He gets the kick in. It goes high. And the Donegal flags at hit 16 rise to acclaim Donegal's opening point by James McHugh. That was good work by McHugh. He was under an awful lot of pressure. Five Mayo backs, in fact. And he still had the presence of mind and the power to kick it over.
This was a good score by James McHugh. Didn't panic. Could have laid it back, but decided that he had enough room himself to hook it over the bar.
Kilgallen drives it up towards the full forward line. Well collected there by Barry McGowan, the utility man who came on in the Ulster final and played so well he's retained his place. And now it's Donal Reid. Feeds the ball down along the corner. Joyce McMullen back to Reid again. And still McMullen, there's a chance for Joyce McMullen. Brilliantly come off the line and blocked by Gabriel Irwin. But that is more like the Donegal, it's the short passing Donegal game. The halfback comes up, feeds the half forward. It produced a free.
Donal Reid slips it inside to Joyce McMullen, who had played a 1-2 with him. But this was great work by Gabriel Irwin. Out he come, kept his eye on the ball, got hands to it, a great block. And even Mayo defenders back on the line. Dermot Flanagan there showing his experience, getting in behind his keeper.
Must be added that Joyce McMullen didn't tend to go for the point. Wasn't tempted to go for the free. The result to 45. Declan Bonner takes it. That's more like it from Bonner. And that's the sides level. And away comes Tony Morley. Up underneath the Hogan stand. His foot was out, but the ball certainly wasn't. It's still Morley. Floats it across. Up goes McHale. Gets that ball. Feeds it off. Anthony Finnerty is brilliantly blocked, and there's a chance for Mayo, but Shovlin saw that Gary Walsh had moved off his line and did very well to cover. Maher, still Mayo. Peter Butler, back to Maher again, takes the shot, puts it over, and Mayo are back in front. That's a delightful score for Mayo. Nice interplay between Butler and Maher, and resulted with Maher putting it over the bar for his first score in the championship this year. Donal Reid heavily challenged by Maher. It wasn't shoulder to shoulder despite Sean Maher's protestations. And now it's Brian Murray. Takes the shot quickly. Up and over the bar. And Brian Murray, who had such an inspirational game in this year's Ulster final, certainly has found his accuracy again. And that delightful point brings them level in Croke Park.
Intelligent, confident play that. The quick free taken to Brian Murray going forward. He has had a great championship, and there he showed why he has scored important points for Tyrone or for Donegal so far this year.
Good work by Malloy. McHugh, ever alert, ever waiting for the break. He got it, he was fouled, and there'll be a free for Donegal. Thought about taking it out of the hands.
This break in the middle of the field, very, very important. And I must say Mayo probably got the most of them up into that one from Martin McHugh. Here's Tony Boyle, obviously looking for his free there, and gets it.
Peter Ford wasn't too amused. But Tony Boyle had only one idea when he got that ball. It's a try and go past, and any interference, he will try and encourage the referee, let's say, to give a free, which he did. And with Declan Bonner converted, and Donegal go into the lead for the first time. And just listen to the roar of approval from the Donegal faithful. Meanwhile, TJ Kilgallen is faced with this free kick, almost in the centre of the posts, about 42 metres out. As Mayo play against the breeze in the first half, doesn't really raise the ball. McHale got his fist to it, and whether that come off the crossbar or off Gary Watts, we'll just have to wait and see. But there's no doubt that Gary Watts knew exactly what was going on. And Donegal play control football, bring the ball out of defence through by the guy and pick up Joyce McMullen. So a let off at one end, and what can Donegal do at the other? A nice ball by McMullen. James McHugh has got a man inside him if he wants him. Forced across field he goes. Brother Martin, Joyce McMullen again. Donegal's half forward line trying to get the way through, but run up against a half back line marshalled by Tomás Tierney. And at the moment, the Mayo half back line could be said to be on top. A let off for Donegal, Peter.
Indeed it was. I think Big Liam McHale used his basketball skills there. He palmed that ball towards the goal.
Unlucky Malloy just couldn't hold it. Kevin Staunton did well to pick it up under pressure. Pressurised now by Martin Gavigan. Good play by Gavigan and wonderful work by Staunton. And this produced a chance for Ray Dempsey. And Ray Dempsey kicked it over the bar, but put that score down to the persistence and the playmaking ability of Kevin Staunton, Mayo centre half forward.
A very inventive dummy there by Kevin Staunton, but when he gets it to Morley, he has loads of time. No pressure at all, and just hooks it over the bar. That's the sort of room that Donegal do want to be given these Mayo forwards.
Gallagher needed to get that ball. Liam McHale lurking behind. And now it's Tommy Ryan. Driven in towards Boyle. Boyle gets it. Declan Bonner is outside him. Boyle did very well to keep possession.
He did, but just for a split second, the chance was on for Declan Bonner inside. Tony possibly didn't see him, or decided that the best option was to keep possession and go for his own score. But in any case, this should be a certain point for James McHugh.
Here's the back drop of Hill 16. Makes no mistake, an easy free then for James McHugh. And Donegal back in the lead again. Many people thought moved out in the midfield if Mayo were under pressure. Now whether that's going to be a permanent move, we'll just have to wait and see.
Well, funny, it created a problem as well. Sean Maher got that ball in the wing. He had absolutely nobody to play it into.
Tony Morley bursts his way through. A double foul on him. Matt Gallagher and Noel Hegarty. And there's going to be a free for Mayo.
Really was a
sorry, Jimmy. It really was a soft enough free that, because Tony Morley seemed as if he had got clear of the tackle, clear of the challenge.
Chance for Dempsey then. And he takes it. Gary Walsh now playing with Byrne, of course. That kick out brilliantly collected by TJ Kilgallen. Van Murray trying to get the block in, and now Walsh comes out. But the Mayo forward, Jonathan Jennings, did get his hands to it. But there's the confidence of Donegal again, building from the back. Tommy Ryan blocked. Ray Dempsey blocked him, and now there's another chance. Jonathan Jennings fouled again by Hegarty, and the free on the 13-meter line. Tommy Sugrey indicated the high elbow tackle.
The move of Liam McHale out to the middle of the field on a sort of a, he's just wandered out there, has certainly caused a bit of panic to Donegal. He caught one kick out there himself. They were watching him and allowed TJ Kilgallen to catch the other one. And Donegal have sent out Barry McGowan with him. as Jarrett Jennings puts that one over the bar.
So Jennings, second point then from that free kick, puts Mayo back in the lead. Donal Reid decides to switch the play across. Declan Bonner comes out. You can forget about numbers at Crook Park. The right corner forward feeds it in towards Anthony Molloy. Molloy's a chance. He hesitated, swung it to the left, and swung it wide. And the problems came with that little bit of indecision. He saw Tony Boyle inside, thought about it, the chance was lost. And then when he went back again, the gap had been closed down, and the result was that the ball was kicked wide.
Here he is, just Dermot Flanagan did great work there. He didn't dive at him, made Molloy make up his own mind, and as it turned out, it was too late and it was the wrong option. Another bad wide.
Well, can Anthony Molloy bring the sides level? He's certainly getting another Donegal attack started. Declan Bonner was inside. McHugh was uprooted. I think it would be the best word there. There's a free, and I'm sure Declan Bonner realises that is a perfect opportunity to send the sides in level at half time. Tommy Sugary just checks on James McHugh. Tomás Tierney has a word.
Great work here by James McHugh, taken out as Thomas Tierney went past him. But a very important free for Declan Bonner.
Declan Bonner, no stranger to important frees. And they certainly don't come any more important than that one. It's Declan Bonner's third point. It brings the sides level. And we're now over the 35 minutes in this first semi-final of this year's All-Ireland Championship. Tommy Sugary has checked his watch. He brings the first half to a close, the first half which had incidents at either end. No goals came of it. And the result is that we go off the field at half time with Donegal and Mayo level, 6 points each. The breeze in this half will be favouring Mayo. And there's 35 minutes then between Donegal and a possible appearance in an All-Ireland final, and laying this hoodoo which is supposedly covered then. Their only success here was a grounds tournament game way back 20 years ago in 1972. They played Offaly in the final of that and lost it, and haven't had a win since that date. But they've certainly got an opportunity now thanks to that free on Tony Boyle. Tony came out for the second half, even though I think it was quite apparent that he just wasn't moving with the same fluency as he had done during the Ulster Championship. The result of the foul on him is a free to be taken by James McHugh. An opportunity which goes a-begging. Liam McHale using his height, flicked the ball off. Jarrett Jennings, still Jennings. The overlap, Tony Morley. Morley bursts his way through, he's crossed the 14 metre line. Off the post, a let off for Donegal, but still Tony Morley in pursuit.
There's the shot going in for Tony Morley. Really, it was a miss that he, going at full speed, all he had to do was kick the ball straightly at a certain point.
And the kick out is collected by Liam McHale in the middle of the field. Collected at the second attempt by Sean Maher. McHale again. Still Liam McHale. Forces his way through, looks for support. And from the narrowest of angles, the big Ballina man, who scored a goal and 2 points already in this year's championship, opens his account today with that point, which puts Mayo back into the lead again.
Out of centre-half forward now, it was Liam himself who picked up the break, got it to Sean Maher, and went on and combined beautifully with him. McHale coming in here, looking to play it back out. Goes past Brian Murray very easily there, and from the tightest of angles, just side-puts it over the bar.
Brilliantly caught by McHale, drilled it through. Hegarty does well to get it. Hegarty pulled off the ball, was he, by Dempsey? There's a free, we don't know what direction it's in. Tommy Sugary stands on the 20 metre line, his hand held aloft, and we just have to wait and see where the free is. I think by the reaction of the Donegal defence, it's a free for Mayo. It is, and it'll be taken by Jarlath Jennings.
Again, the influence. People thought coming into this game that Liam McHale could be a very influential figure. and out in the middle of the field he's proven to be just that. The long ball drilled in, and Noel Hegarty had a hout of the jersey before the ball came in.
Charlotte Jennings on the 20 metre line, his third point, and the gap now goes to two. Just look at Martin McHugh, he's in his own half, trying to set the play up, fouled by Tierney, or was he? Still McHugh, races at the Mayo defence, Manus Boyle. There's that nameless looking kick again. Who will the break favour? Six Mayo men under it. Tony Boyle left footed, kicks it over. But once he got the space, his opening point today. And after 13 minutes in the second half, Donegal's opening score comes from Tony Boyle. And there's just a point between them. Midway through the second half, Kilgallen goes up. The ball breaks in, sweeps McHugh. Still Martin McHugh. Tony Boyle pulled to the ground by Peter Ford. And you can't say that Tommy Sugar wasn't on top of the play. Peter Ford goes over and apologises. And I think as soon as he had done it, he realised what he had done. So did Tommy Sugar. And Peter Ford then becomes the third Mayo man to go into Tommy Sugar's notebook.
It's a coincidence that both the number 11s, when they start to play well, Liam McHale on one side and Martin McHugh on the other, things start to really buzz for their teams. McHugh now, in this period of Donegal ascendancy, involved in almost everything.
Manus Boyle puts it over, brings them level, and now it's on the platform. Will those points restore Donegal's confidence? Manus Boyle has certainly made his presence felt. Declan Bonner still maintains possession. Shrugs off Dermot Flanagan. And Manus Boyle has certainly given Donegal more options. James McHugh forces his way across field. Still gets possession. Still McHugh. And fouled. And now, can Donegal make use of yet another free scoring opportunity? Manus Boyle certainly isn't shrugging off the challenge.
Well, I'd say one of the reasons Manus Boyle was put in was to cure the free-taking problem here. If the likes of James McHugh are going to be running at defences and drawing fouls, as in this case, Donegal must have a proven free-taker. Although I'm sure manager Brian McAniff was wondering about his decision when Manus missed his first free.
Well, Manus was Mr. Accuracy himself in last year's championship. And his accuracy hasn't deserted him as Donegal go back in the lead. Manus Boyle, second point. And Donegal flags, which were dormant for so long, have suddenly sprung to life around a packed Crook Park. Donald Reid, he has Declan Bonner outside him, but that's more in hope than anything else. There's a chance, Brian Murray still gets it. Bonner on the outside if he needs him. It's still Declan Bonner, he's going to try and get on the left foot. He does, but even from that distance, he managed to put it wide, but he'd be very grateful to Tommy Sigley. He spotted a foul on Declan Bonner. So Donegal, after all of that, are going
great
to have
play.
A chance.
Great play here by Brian Murray. Uses Declan Bonner on the run, and Tommy Sugar up at the play. Saw that pull by Thomas Tierney. I presume if the point had gone over, he would have allowed it to stand, but in this case, it's a free for Donegal. Declan Bonner will be the taker.
So after all of that then, Brian McDonald, the Mayo manager, a worried man at the moment, I could suggest, shouting out his instructions as Declan Bonner takes this relatively easy free, and that's what it proves to be. Donegal lead by 2 points with 9 minutes to go in the second half. 4 points to Declan Bonner. By McGann and then to Malloy. Malloy. Now, this is where the fitness comes in. Cunningham is pulled to the ground, and the slap indicated by Tommy Sugar, the upraised hand, and yet another chance for Donegal.
If in the early part of this half Donegal appeared to be shooting themselves in the foot, Mayo is certainly doing that now. That last pass into the Donegal defence was hopeless, and has really resulted in this chance for Manus Boyle.
So Manus Boyle brought on to do a job. He scored 2 points already, and the flags on the canal end went up before the umpire had a chance to wave the white flag. Manus Boyle's third point, 5 minutes to go, and Donegal lead by 3. Irwin in a hurry, out to the midfield area it goes. The break favours McHale. Still McHale. Drills the ball in. Danger for Donegal. The man in over on PJ Kilgallen. He scored a point at this stage in the Connacht final. On that occasion he's won a free.
His powerful run there through the middle. McHale again getting the move going. Played inside to Ray Dempsey and flicked off to Kilgallen. And because he was going so fast, big strong man running at the defence, they had to get him stopped, and it was an elbow that brought him to a halt. Jarrett Jennings with the resultant free.
4 points to Jennings, and a rather muted roar greeted that one.
But it really put the game back in the net, but now just 2 points between the sides.
One kick, a goal for Mayo could certainly put Donegal's chances to rest.
Every ball now in the middle of the field from now to the end of this game is going to be vitally important. Either clean catches or breaks, it doesn't really matter.
Well, such is the colour in Croke Park, I don't think there's anyone left on Donegal today. Tomás Tierney. 6 Connacht Championship medals he has, 5 with Galway and 1 this year with Mayo. That ball was blocked and his absolute number, Martin Gavin, collects it. And that's Anthony Malloy, the Donegal captain, the man from Margrath, pumps it in towards Tony Boyle. The man who was doubtful before the match gets possession. Still Boyle goes past Peter Ford, takes the kick over the bar, and that was an inspirational score from the Donegal full forward. Collected it, did all the hard work, worked his way in, put it over, and the margin is 3 points again. Flanagan. Rather in this ball. Just think where James McHugh is. Forget about numbers. At the moment, this game's all about heart. It's all about commitment. It's all about passion. And at the moment, it's all Donegal. I can't say that there'd be a great rush to take this free.
Donegal now starting to play the possession football that they showed was their 40 in the second half of the Ulster final. Players running all over the place, going short, helping each other out. They must keep working now for the remaining minute or so of this game.
Donal Reid, I'm sure he didn't think when he wasn't on at the start of this year's Ulster Championship against Cavan that he'd be here in Croke Park just a minute from reaching the All-Ireland final. Tommy Sigrew, a hot ball between Liam McHale and anyone else who cares to come up with him, because McHale collects it easily. Will this be Mayo's last chance? Ray Dempsey floats it in. The accuracy wasn't good. Martin Shovlin allows it to run to Gary Walsh. Declan Bonner. The short passing game. Gavigan bursts his way past Liam McHale. Pumps it into the corner. Tony Boyle. Irwin comes off the side. Tony Boyle gets it. He's got a man inside of his Barry Cunningham. Still Cunningham. The chance. Fouled. And we've a penalty. Tony Boyle throws his arms aloft in the corner. It was his pass to Cunningham, which saw Cunningham being fouled. He shipped a heavy tackle with a penalty. And Donegal flags are in the air as Croke Park for once comes to a stop.
Tony Boyle gets it inside to Cunningham. And he knew with the goalkeeper out that he had to go for goal. In he goes, and it was Tomás Tierney who came back and tackled him with the foot. Knocked the ball away, but Tommy Sugar adjusts that he had fouled him, and it's a penalty, and this game is really all over now.
Brian McAniver's out in the field issuing instructions. I'm not a mind reader, and there's tears of joy from Donegal folk. I would say the instructions will be to go for the point.
But really, with time up at the clock, 3 points in it.
And
it was the right decision.
The point is marked into the book. Now whether Tommy Sugar has called full time or not, we'll just have to wait and see. The Donegal players think that he has. He's called for the ball, and Donegal, this year's Ulster champions, go into the All-Ireland final. They've beaten Mayo by a score of Donegal 13 points, Mayo 9 points. And for the second year in a row, an Ulster team goes into the All-Ireland final.
Tears stealing through as Donegal finally come of age. An All-Ireland final at the fifth time of asking. An important result for Donegal and an important result for Ulster football too. Maybe the Sam Maguire will stay in the province. And by the way, our apologies for some slight disturbances in picture during the game. Well, after the game, Owen McConnon caught up with the Donegal team and first he asked Brian McInniff how he felt.
I feel marvellous, Owen. It's a great occasion, and you know, and I'm selfish enough to say a great occasion for myself, but more so for the boys and for the people of Donegal that have so long yearned for this occasion and so long deserved it, because as a young boy, I remember being left at the train station in Madonna in 52 when I went off to the first National League semi-final. Again, in 63, I was in Canada. And then as player manager in 72, when we made the breakthrough. And early, we came a wee bit early in 83 with a very young side, and it took us a long time to get back in 1990. And then me, a great side, beat us in 1990, and last year's disappointment. But today, a great day for Donegal.
I think what happened today, and maybe first half especially, we landed a lot of balls in the keeper's hands, and I think people got afraid then to kick. And maybe we tried to work the ball too far, and even when we were ahead there, maybe 2 or 3 points, we should have kicked points from 30 yards out, and we tried to play the ball in. But with the way Donegal players happen, a fella might have a ball 30 yards out and there are two men in position to give it to him, and sometimes they give it to him and maybe it's the wrong option, he should go for his own point. But maybe we definitely overplayed the ball today.
Donegal have got a great panel of players this year. We've got as good lads on the bench as the lads that are playing. Like, and that showed there today. Barry Cunningham was brought into the midfield area and he done a great job when he came in, and Manus Boyle was brought in as well. And he done a great job. He got a few frees that were vital to us at that stage. You know, so it was great. All around the field, there are lads that can do the job there. When things are not going all that well.
Realistically, you would love to win the All Ireland final at this time round.
Yeah, it'd be great for Donegal now to win All Ireland, and we realise it's definitely our best chance because we're there now. We're 70 minutes away from creating history as a bunch of lads. There's no bunch of lads to serve it more than this bunch of lads in the Donegal panel at the minute. Most of them have won under 21 All Ireland in 82 and 87, and now we're not just coming up to make up the numbers in the final. We believe we're good enough to win, and we believe that at the start, even though that the first match in Cavan there were times that looked bad for us, but we're there now in the final.
Martin McHugh's penalty. You obviously instructed him to tip the ball over the bar. That was the insurance.
Oh, yes. Well, that would go without saying, although at one stage when he said to me that the referee said it was the last kick of the game, I did turn to him and I says, go for the goal. But he says, no, I says, I'll take my point. And he was right.
Obviously, it's the ultimate goal now, surely.
Yes, we'll be 5 weeks to prepare, and I'm looking forward to the 5 weeks. It'll be great for the county, it'll be great for the squad of players, and I think it'll give Donegal as a county a great lift that it has deserved for a long lot of years because of the input to the GAA games. And I'm looking forward to the 5 weeks training that are coming up, and we've a lot of work to do, Owen, because that performance that we had out there today will not do against the winners of the next semi-final. We're going to have to go up another notch to win an All-Ireland final.
Brian McInniff, a happy man. Well, our regular analyst, Sean McCaig, is with me now. Sean, were you pleased with Donegal's performance?
Well, I was certainly delighted with the result. I must congratulate Donegal wholeheartedly. They have done what, a historic day for them. They have done what they have always wished to do, and I must particularly congratulate Brian. He's been associated with all the Donegal teams that have won Ulster championships, and it's a great day for him and for Donegal people everywhere, at home and abroad, so I'm delighted for them.
But what about the quality of the performance?
Well, when they get time to look at it in a week or whatever, they will realise that they should have won the game probably much more easily than they actually did. They dominated play right through, particularly in the second half, and they will feel that they missed too many chances, and that when you have 16 wide, 7 of which are from scorable frees, they will be asking a lot of questions about the small things that will make the difference in an All-Ireland final.
One of the things early on they seemed to do was over-elaborate. The forwards holding on to the ball maybe too much and not taking the direct route.
Yeah, well, I suppose this is a criticism of Donegal generally in relation to overplaying the ball, but it is really playing to their strength in that Donegal players are basically small and light and they need the interchanging short passing game because many of them are not in a position to win just 50-50 ball with a fella who is physically stronger. Here we have a good movement where Joyce McMullen on the ball, has, you know, gives it, makes himself available for the return pass. And so often in the past, Joyce would have stuck this one in the net. But, you know, we can see that suited Joyce, and a good save from Gabriel Ehrman. But we can't criticise them too much because that suits the panel they have.
But as we said, they did miss a lot of chances. They almost kicked themselves out of it, didn't they?
Yes, as I said, they had 16 wides. And as well as that, they also had a number of chances that they kicked tentatively to the goalkeeper and several other chances when they didn't shoot at all. But, you know, they will see that and they will realise, as Mark McHugh said, that if you're to win an All-Ireland, you must be taking your chances once you get to 40 yards. And, you know, the misses today will be maybe opportunities that they will hope will present themselves again next day.
Hopefully, yes. Well, what about the chance Liam McHale had now? He was a threat, of course, at full forward, and he nearly got a goal.
Yes, obviously, with his height around the square, you know, there was always on that he might get a touch to one of these high balls into the square. Here, a magnificent flick from him, and Gary Walsh may have had it covered, but it hit the crossbar, and Martin Shovlin reacted quickly. That was the type of situation that Donegal probably feared. We must give all credit, though, to Matt Gallagher, who had a magnificent game right through at full-back. Right from the beginning, he was on top, he was breaking the ball, and his positional sense and his distribution were excellent. A great game.
That's right, yeah. Well, what about early in the second half? It was level, and Donegal had, or rather Mayo had a great chance, and things could have been very different. I think it was Morley hit the post. Imagine if he had got a goal there.
Yes, well, Donegal started the second half and missed four chances, two of which were easy scoreable frees. And, you know, at that stage, the heads probably would have gone down had Mayo got a score. But, you know, it just didn't come for Mayo.
But then Brian McAniff made a few changes, a few super subs, and Manus Boyle was one of them, and his accuracy was much needed. He really settled him.
Well, Barry Cunningham's contribution and Manus from place balls, those were excellent substitutions. It shows the strength and depth that Donegal have. Manus scored 3 points from frees, and while he contributed somewhat less from play, it's great to have players of that quality. Barry Cunningham's contribution when he came to midfield was really excellent also. Brian is a very astute man, and he's around a long time. He can read the game well, and he certainly made the right options today.
The penalty right at the end for Donegal clinched it, and as you say, Barry Cunningham had a big part to play in it.
Yes, Tony Boyle obviously realised from early on that if he ran at Peter Ford and if he ran at the Mayo defence, that some of the times he would get through. And here he got past the goalkeeper. Barry Cunningham did the right thing. He made straight lines to the square, and Martin McHugh took the smart option for Martin, 4 points in front and time up. Why not?
Very smart, and I think he was quite happy with it as well. Sean, thanks very much, and well done, Donegal. Now, we talked about Donegal making history today. Well, the miners from Armagh were trying to bridge a very long gap in their history. Not since 1957 had they reached the All-Ireland Minor Final. Today, their opponents were Roscommon. Barry O'Hagan and Paul McGrain are a useful midfield pairing. Dermot Marsden is very highly rated at centre-half forward, while in the back line, Conor Wilson and Eddie Martin played well in the Ulster Championship. Roscommon have their captain, Rosso O'Callaghan, back at midfield. He missed the Connacht final because of injury. In attack, Frank Farrell is a potential match winner, while goalkeeper Raymond Lennon has impressed. The commentator, Owen McConnon.
Barry Hughes. Kicking it into the space in front of goal. Nicely picked up by Dermot Marsden. Gives it in now to Damien Jordan. Looks for a goal. It decided to fist the ball. He fisted it wide. And that's a let-off for Roscommon. Nicely through into the path of Damien Jordan. Had goal on his mind. Good tackling, though, it must be said, by the cornerback, Pádraig Kelly, and he fists the ball wide. And again, the race for possession. Neatly picked up, this time by Barry Hughes. The tackling is good, but Hughes will get his kick in, and Hughes gets his point. Barry Hughes from Ballyhagen. That's a goal and 5 points he scored in the championship. Armagh lead, collected the ball beautifully. The tackling was by Richard Glover, evaded the tackle, got his kick in, and Armagh are in front for the first time. It's Dury in possession. Nice crossfield ball, very clever, to Dermot Washington. Dermot is dangerous on the attack, and that's the reason why. That's Washington's third point. Adrian Dury now for Roscommon. Keith Murphy decided to go himself. That is an excellent score. Keith Murphy gets it. It's his first score of the championship. A very important one indeed. Danger man Washington again. Kieran Malley certainly has his hands full this afternoon. Washington still in possession, gets his kick in and gets the point. That's superb play by the corner forward. First touch for Eamon Ferran, and that'll do his confidence a world of good. Great fielding by Mackin, gives it to Midleenan. His first touch let it down. Dermot Marsden, can he get the shot? Yes! Dermot Marsden from Clannagale. Great linking, Des Mackin, Niall Midleenan, and finishing with Dermot Marsden, 6 points to five. Armagh back in front. This was Midleenan's run. Overplayed the ball a little bit, lost possession, flicked it beautifully back into the path of Dermot Marsden, and what a finish. Great goal. Sean Casey sets up another attack, but again it's Washington. Dermot Washington be tackled, but does evade the tackle, does get his kick in, and does get a point. Exhibition stuff from Washington. Headed on again by Mackin, and a chance now for Paul McNulty. Is it goal two? No! He's missed it! And that's the third shot at goal they've missed. Full credit though to Ray Lannan. He rushed quickly off his line, left the angle very narrow, and the ball swung to the right and wide. So a let off for Roscommon. And now a chance for Dermot Marsden. Has Mackin with him? Will he use Mackin? The answer is yes. Went for it himself, he had a player with him. Rushed his shot and the ball gone wide. Sean Casey into the open space towards Adrian Dury. Very hefty and timely challenge by Eamon Ferran. Hughes adds to it. But again, it's Sean Casey. Dangerous ball in front of goal. A chance here perhaps, but it's over the bar. Keith Murphy, the scorer, gives the lead back to Roscommon. 7 points to six. And we've played 20 minutes in the first half. Ball went loose from the high kick in. Had goal on his mind perhaps for a minute, but Keith Murphy happy to put the ball over the bar. Des Mackin gives it quickly to Dermot Marsden. And now a chance for Barry Hughes. Great save. A superb save by Ray Lannan. Barry Hughes found the space yet again. Lannan quickly off his line. A beautiful pass from Dermot Marsden. And from that angle, he should have been putting the ball in the back of the net. Marsden has room in which to manoeuvre. Good running by Marsden, clever player, gets his kick in and gets his point. Great work by Dermot Marsden from Clannagale, reduces the deficit to a single point. It's Roscommon 8, Armagh 1-4. This is Dermot Marsden, he's now operating at full forward. A clever ball in front of goal, it's a 2-on-2 situation, it's down to 1-on-1 now. Midleenan wins. Damien Jordan. The ball blocked down. The chance for Des Mackin. Yes! Des Mackin from St. Pat's has got the goal. And just what Armagh needed before halftime. They lead 2-4 to Roscommon's 8 points. The initial ball came in from Damien Jordan. The goalkeeper did well. Really, he should have anticipated that block. Good work by Mackin. And a great finish by Des Mackin. Michael Hanratty. Great first time football by Armagh. Can they finish with a score? They look for the score. They get it. Paul McNulty from Mullamore. The flick into the path of Paul McNulty. Beautifully done. Had plenty of space and found the required space and chipped over the bar by Ray Lannan. Rossa O'Callaghan, the team captain from Roscommon, will want to lead by example. Liam Murray. Kerry McLaughlin. Keith Murphy. They're in possession, not making a lot of ground though. Look to the corner, back for inspiration. And a chance now, but a great save. Still not out of the woods, and it's over the bar by Dermot Washington. He holds his head, shakes it and says, my goodness me, that should have been in the back of the net. And really it should. The high ball dropping down in front of goal. The first shot was brilliantly saved by the cornerback. Eddie Martin unable to clear it. Nicely won. The shot looks good from here. The umpires agree. And Barry O'Hagan gets a second point. The man from Clannagale, Dermot Washington. Floating it in front of goal. Chance here, but again the cover's positive, again the cover's good. Eddie Martin doing very well. Conor Connolly gets his kick in. Conor Connolly gets a point. Liam Murray it was first, 16 points to 11. 2-10 for Armagh, 11 points for Roscommon. Barry O'Hagan. There's a tendency to swing that ball towards that far side. Oh, very well won. A chance now for Macken. Yes! Des Macken gets the goal. But what a superb catch by Declan Toner. It's now 3-10 for Armagh and 11 points for Roscommon. And the Archer County Aaron Song. This was Toner. Gave the pass a beautiful angle. And the goalkeeper actually turned his back on the shot. Paul McGrain playing a captain's part in the middle of the field. Gives it to Barry Hughes. The gap's in front of goal. Hughes flicks it and Hughes gets the point. That's a goal and 6 points. Barry Hughes has scored in this year's championship. Connor Wilson. And that's a free, surely. The referee says play on. And it's Toner again. A great save by the keeper. He had Des Macken with him. Toner decided to go alone. And Ray Lannan held his position on the line. Roscommon need to go forward. They need to get scores. The tackling is good by Andrew McCann. Murphy fouled. Takes the quick free. First touch for Francis Graham. Looks for his point, then gets it. Barry O'Hagan. He'll take the point. Looks up, gets the point.
Armagh in the final for the first time in 35 years. By the way, they've only won the title once. That was way back in 1949. One piece of bad news is that Michael Hanratty, who was carried off, has a suspected broken collarbone. There was a third game at Croke Park today and it involved the minor hurlers of Antrim. They scored 3 goals but lost. The goals came from Aidan Mort, Joe O'Boyle and PJ Mullen. Waterford finished 9 points the better. In Camogie, Down had a good win, 213 to 212 over Clare, as narrow as you like, just 1 point. In the Ulster Club Hurling Championship, Dungannon beat Castle Blaney, while Lisbelaw and Mullaghorin played out a draw. In the Down Hurling Championship, Ballycran and Ballygalgett drew tonight, 2-14 each. Ballygalgett equalised with a Kevin Coulter free from 60 metres right on the whistle. The other semi-final was postponed. In football, 2 quarter-finals in Derry, Ballinascreen without the injured Eamon Burns, one with a late goal from Sean D. O'Neill, while Lavie's 3 goals came from Ollie Collins, Seamus Downey and John McGurk. Lavie play Dungiven next. Ballinascreen will meet Glen in the other semi-final. And some league results in Tyrone, Coeliland 1-5, Omagh 15 points, Gorchan 3-7, Dungannon 2-10, Pomeroy 1-7, Trillick 1-7, Moy 6 points, Galbally 2-12, and Derry Loughan 2-11, Clonoe 1-7. In the Down Tournament Final, Downpatrick 2-7, Burren 10 points. And in Monaghan's Intermediate Hurling Championship, Truagh 2-7, Enniskeen 1-7. Sorry, that's 2-5 to 1-7, a win for Truagh. Which brings me nicely back to the former Monaghan football manager, Sean McCaig. And we could look ahead to next week, Dublin against Clare. Who do you fancy?
Well, obviously, my heart would say Clare, but I think my head would say Dublin. They must be favourites going into the game. I can appreciate Clare's dilemma after so long an absence from Croke Park at All-Ireland semi-final. You know, they will come in and they will be affected by the nerves, and they will be affected by the fact that Dublin are playing on a ground that they're so used to. And it's very difficult to see that Clare would upset the odds.
Who would Donegal prefer to meet, do you think?
Well, I feel that Donegal play their best football when they feel that they're under pressure and when they're up against it. And consequently, I feel it would suit them better if they were playing Dublin. Should Dublin beat Clare, I feel that Donegal would certainly be highly motivated. It would be a great challenge, and it would be a great All-Ireland to win, beating a recognised strong team like Dublin.
But Donegal seemed to have a lot of problems. They changed both their wing half forwards today. Declan Bonner was off form. They could make changes for the final. They seem to have some problems.
Well, you know, every game is different. The fellas who may have appeared to have problems today may be the star players of next day. They have a very strong panel, and I'm quite sure that if there are players in difficulty, Brian will make the necessary changes. I feel that it will be a complete new situation, probably a game totally unrelated or unlike today's game. So we'll have to wait and see. They're certainly in there with a 50-50 chance at this stage.
Barry Cunningham's in there. He played well today. He'll be looking for a place. Manus Boyle came in, players like that.
Yes, they are there, and as I said, there are other very strong contenders in the panel also, like John Cunningham and John Joe Doherty. There are numerous other players in the Donegal panel with great experience now. This is the strongest Donegal panel I've ever seen, and I think they'll do well.
Good words from Sean there for Donegal. Thanks very much, Sean. Now, the All-Ireland final will be held on the 20th of September, 5 weeks today. We'll be there, and so will Donegal, for the first time. They suffered and laboured along the way, but it's been worth it. The county is known for its beautiful scenery. Now it may be known for an All-Ireland football champion team as well. From us all, good night.